Tonight.
You are listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
All right. This is the Doug Stanhope Podcast with the Impractical Jokers at the Super Bowl party here in Bissbee, Arizona. Goes on for a long time. There's two parts because Sal didn't show up the first night because he's a, well, he's not a cunt like that, but he's a, yeah, what a fucking cunt for not being here the first night.
The potato peelings in the sink did not turn into vodka as I had hoped. I only start to need a drink after the liquor stores have closed. I heard you change your name again. Don't you change your hair. It was the only thing I liked about you in the end. La, la, la.
This is the most sober I've ever been after a Super Bowl.
Is it really?
By the end, I'm usually just, I almost
this
feel like.
This is amazing right now. We'll probably have a shot as well, I think.
Would you like one?
I mean, I'm not going to let him do one and not me have one.
He would never do that to me.
Oh, I mean, I'm a true friend.
This is...
I'm so glad that you're here for this because I had to do it solo last night and I was drunk beyond my mind and I felt like I let everybody down. But just you being here, like, I feel just some of the energy flowing
into
me.
Who are?
Who is here? Who is here, Doug? Where are we?
Okay, right there, yes.
I was driving from Tucson to here last night. I don't know what happened to my mom. She had a conniption. She texted me 30 times. She was so worried I was going to get stuck in the desert. And she was like, I need
like
to know
casino?
Your location. Who are you going to visit? The address, the hotel, the location. What is it? What car rental do you have? What's
stay
car
on mic.
Yeah. Oh, are we
oh,
on?
You just won a fucking award?
Are we on? Oh, I didn't know it was up and running.
Yeah, you're not
I
supposed to touch that.
Okay. I didn't know it was up and running.
Hey, don't touch
okay.
that.
It's up and running. He always starts as soon as we're in here.
Oh, okay.
So tell us about your mother.
So your mother...
She's home, and her name is Adele, and she's very worried. And then I told her, I'm going... And she said, well, who's your friend? And I said, it's Doug Stanhope, Mom. And she said, fine. And she said, oh, are you staying at his house? I said, no, I'm staying nearby. And then I said, where? She said, where are you staying? I said, the Shady Dell. Look it up. Her name is Adele.
Does she know so how to work Google?
She looked it up. She did. She looked it up, and she texted me back, it's a trailer park. I said, yeah, it's a really cool one. Or whatever. And she goes, I looked. I said, look up Bissbee, Arizona. That's where I am. She looked it up, and in the, like, I guess Wikipedia or whatever, it says, like, notable. Like, you're, like, the mayor or whatever. And she's like, your friend is mentioned when they mention Bissbee or whatever. And I was like, yeah, I know. And she's like, your friend is a comedian. I said, what can we do to move on?
Ma, do you read my diaries too?
What can we do to move on? I'm driving to
Bisbee's in Arizona, Sal.
That's near Mexico where all the drug wars are being fought. You're going to get kidnapped by a cartel.
You going to do the shot with me or what? We're going to sit here all night? What are we doing?
Oh, my God.
Brian went ahead and
take
did his already.
Take that one.
Scottish.
I got vodka shots.
I'll be
with
drinking
a vodka
for the
bulk
in a minute. So
excellent.
To the most Super Bowl I've ever.
Yes.
Shitty game.
Right. Ooh, Jesus. Where's the vodka that's meant to be coming?
Yeah. No. You're. I was.
Wow.
Yeah. I was asking if you could bring it like a bottle for the crew. Oh, good. Okay. Thanks.
Ooh.
Fucking Meatwig, my cat, heckled last night's podcast.
Meatwig made me happy, though.
No, you can leave him in. He'll just cry at the door otherwise.
It wasn't the cat meowing. It was Junior sitting on the floor making fart noises for 2-3 minutes straight. That I think might have interrupted the flow. Where is he?
How did we open the podcast last night?
By saying who's here and what we're doing.
Right.
Okay. No, I think it was something else.
I don't remember the podcast last night, so you'll have to inform me.
You said something about, I thought you were saying to throw this to him, but it was a fuck Sal.
Well, first it was fuck Mur. First it was fuck. Well, they were talking about punishments and increasing punishments. And, and I said you made me teach my parents sex ed. So
that's right.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
yeah.
Well, Murray will never listen to this. So go. He can go fuck himself.
Right. You see how it works, Doug? You didn't see that? There's no. We.
He'll never listen to this ever in a million years. So
I won't
well
either.
You, I might as well tell you everything about him. If it's fuck Sal, that's fine because you know what? You can't win them all.
Murray was my original favorite Beatle.
That's crazy. If only you knew how he was in real life.
But then it was Quinn, because Quinn talked back to me on Twitter.
Oh, there you go.
All
see?
The rest of them.
Right.
There's a lesson for the rest of the world.
But you know
there.
What? Now I think Sal's grown on me as my favorite Beatle. I hate to.
I could tell the two of you. I watch you two across the party chatting a lot together.
Well, no, because Sal seems the most squeamish of everyone on the show.
Well, we get here. And I don't want to say you're playing favorites off the bat, Doug. But like, there's a bathroom roped off for Sal.
That's right.
It says Sal can use this bathroom.
I mean, because the place is a shithole.
Well, yeah, but is it not a shithole for all of us?
It's not a shithole. The place is.
There's a lot of. But I'm saying it's dirty and dusty, and we're not clean people. It's painted bright.
No.
But yeah, Bingo went in there and disinfected because she knows you have the fucking germaphobe thing.
Right.
So she went in. It stank like bleach in a new nursing home. And went in every crevice and corner to make sure that place was germ-free for you.
I don't know the last time I've been more like honored. Like that was the sweetest, nicest thing. There was 100 people here tonight. And maybe I'm just guessing. There might have been 3,000 people here tonight. It's a quick estimation. And there was a bathroom that had my name on it. It said, I'm only allowed. It said, Sal's. I have the pictures. What's up?
Okay.
And then I went in and there was towels. It said, just Sal's towels. And the toilet said, Sal's toilet. Which I think really went the extra mile because the door said, Sal's bathroom. So no one should have gone past that door. But there was added layers of protection inside the bathroom in case someone forbade the door. They went and they were like, oh, I'm going to piss in here. It's Sal's bathroom. Oh, I can't. It's Sal's toilet.
That whole house is off limits anyway. And only Greg and Chaille, our producer here, he and his wife stay in there. And that's like the safe house away from the party if you have to do coke or something.
Well, I stuck in a pistol over the seat, so I hope you didn't.
You wouldn't have it?
Yeah, I went right into your bathroom, pissed all over the seat. All over it, out of spite. Like, I could have aimed. I could have hit the water, but what I did was I pissed on the sign that said Sal, soaked that, and then right on the seat.
I mean,
I don't like it.
I guess that's punk rock, but what you did really. What you did really, though, was you just shat all over the sentiment. Mm-hmm. That the piss was really shitting on the whole idea, which was a very kind gesture.
That was my intention.
Germaphobes exactly generally annoy me to death. Like one of my biggest fears when I go on Stern is coughing because I have a smoker's fucking fleshy cough. And I know he wants to put a fucking SARS mask on anytime I'm there. And generally, germaphobes annoy me. But because of the show, watching them fuck with your germaphobia makes that okay. Okay, he can take it to an extent. Because, I would, if I knew you better, I'd piss all over your seat.
They've humanized me, We're real people, so.
When did you first notice your germaphobia?
I'll say this like I always say it. I don't really think I'm a germaphobe, like, to the point where people are, like,
Howie Mandel.
Right. I don't think that, like, as good as it gets where he's like...
Mr. Burns.
Yeah. I just think that they get on me. I think it's a little bit magnified, a little bit, but...
Okay, so when did you first notice your job?
Okay, it was about 25 years ago.
The first time he was digging through elephant shit for his keys.
That was 102 degrees that day.
Ugh.
I will tell you, it's more I have a very weak immune system. And so if someone... And you know how people go, this is what I really like. People think they know my body better than I know my body, and I really know my body, So if someone sneezes next to me, I can sense within 5 minutes if I'll be sick that night from it. I really can. And I'll literally say, whelp. I'll say the word whelp. I say, welp. I'm going to be sick in about 3 to 4 hours. And they go, ha, 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 you're such an idiot. You're not going to be sick. That's not how it works. This has happened thousands of times throughout my life. And I say, no, no, that's how it works. That's how it works. And in 4 hours, I literally start having to OD.
Is this in on airplanes and in the subway?
It's everywhere.
That's the New Yorkers live in the filthiest fucking place on earth, and they're always hand sanitizing. Just move to a cleaner place. It makes no sense to them. You can't avoid fucking germs in New York.
Yeah. Oh, I don't touch anything. And everyone says this to me too. You know, you're doing yourself a disservice with a hand sanitizer because you're killing the good germs.
Mm-hmm. Or weakening your immune system.
You're not giving your immune system
natural antibodies
chance to work out.
And what you say to that is what?
I say, give me a break.
Yeah, but I don't know.
Give me a break, you said. I was just Nell Carter's estate sues him.
I say, give me a break. Yeah, yeah. But you give me a break because I sure need one.
No more because we'll have to pay royalties.
But you're sick a lot, right?
Yeah.
You're sick a lot.
Yeah.
And you take all these vitamins.
Yeah.
And you do all the hand sanitizer.
Yeah.
So it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So either you would stop taking that stuff and you would die.
Yeah.
Like that's the only thing keeping you alive is hand sanitizer and vitamins.
Yeah.
Or you would have a healthy full immune system.
I don't know if I'm sick a lot. It's just that if I get sick, it's common cold 6 to 8 weeks.
Right.
What? Yeah. By the time it really gets out of my system.
Wow.
I don't really know. I don't know what happened to me.
You've been fucking a lot of Haitians. By the way, Emily's here. Emily, whose urine is cooling in a refrigerator as we speak. By the time this podcast goes out,
right?
I'm assuming on YouTube there will be the traditional...
Right.
Oh, urine roulette between me and Q.
Very excited about this. Because I feel like a win. Not,
but I thought when you said you'd do it.
Yeah.
If it's Emily's piss.
Right.
I go, then I have to step up. Wow. I can't have you play a local.
Yeah, that would be horrible. I wouldn't want to do it.
And who's going to.
And how's it going to work?
Kenny gets no hits out six on YouTube.
12 pistols get laid out?
No,
six.
We're going to use just. Six. Okay, we have six. We couldn't find squirt guns. You can't find.
I bought you a special Russian roulette
and it didn't work.
Oh.
Urine roulette is Russian roulette where five squirt guns have tequila, one has urine.
Right.
And we do it deer hunter style with a fucking raving lunatic crowd shouting, Dee Dee Mao, Dee Dee Mao. And you pick a squirt bottle. We don't have guns. They're squirt bottles.
Right.
It's not. And
we have an added feature this year. All six of the squirt apparatus have a number so people can place side bets.
Oh, wow.
From the beginning.
Oh, my God.
On which.
Oh, there's betting.
Yes. So betting can go on in the beginning on which number overall will be it. And then you can just do a side bet on whether this is the one or not. So,
all right.
We've added that. A lot of betting going on.
So, yeah, we'll flip a coin to see who goes first.
All right.
You've played this before, is that correct?
We played it once in Death Valley years ago.
And you, who played?
No, the first time I played against... We had this party we used to do for like 7 years in the middle of nowhere in Death Valley. And some douchebag Hollywood guy crashed it. Or showed up. I still don't know but he was kind of a douche. So we made him play, and I lost on the second gun. He got tequila. First gun, I got pissed. So last we never recreated it till last year's Super Bowl party, and Bingo played against Shawnee, who built half that house.
Right.
And it went to the fifth gun.
Buzzer, to the buzzer. It's the best you could ask for.
Yeah. Yeah. But
that's right, because if that last gun is left.
No, it was second to last. Oh, there was still a chance that.
But when you went, it was 50-50. That was it.
But you could see on her face when she squirted. I was actually doing the squirting then. Tracy's pee. Yeah. That's the thing. If you have a hot chick piss in the, then it people are more, like,
it's somewhat palatable.
Yeah, no one's,
How could the hotness of a person affect the quality of the urine?
It's psychological.
It is just obvious.
Junior, you come to me, you say, do you want to play with Junior? Junior Skopka's pissed. And I'm like, no, I don't. I got to go, guys. I got to get the fuck out of here. You know, Emily's pissed. It's like, all right, I might even pay for that in some countries. So, you know, here we are.
So, yeah, that will be on YouTube. We'll see who wins that.
God, I hope I win.
Battle of the Jokers. Was
joke off.
No.
Couple of joke offs.
It's a Joker. Joker's Wild. I'm trying to reference when you do the Joker verse. Joker versus Joker challenge. Right. That's what I'm trying.
It's not me versus him. I mean, I'm not doing this.
Yeah, no. okay. I was just trying to throw out a reference of your show.
If you want a just really good capper to the video, as soon as someone has pissed, put it on me because there's going to be projectile vomit.
Bear in mind, we do have the keys to the place you're staying. Don't laugh that loud.
The Shady Dell. This podcast is brought to you by The Shady Dell. TheShadyDell.com. It's a vintage trailer park here in Bisbee where you guys are staying.
It's unbelievable.
We look for reasons to stay there. Hey, let's get the house fumigated for termites so we have a reason to go a mile down the road and stay.
It's beautiful.
I got married on the boat you're staying
in. I heard that. Did you consummate it inside the boat?
Kind of.
Yeah. All right.
What does kind of mean?
No, he consummated it at the Mexican restaurant down the street shortly after the wedding, where his wife was so drunk and awful and cunty and just really bad, angry, drunk, and yelling about everything. And at some point he goes, if you touch that again, I'll stab your fucking finger with a fork, you cunt. And then most of us...
like that in those days.
The Mexican restaurant in Old Bisbee?
No, it's...
it's nearby.
It's not around anymore.
Nothing in Bisbee stays open for more than 18 months. Everyone has great dreams.
Really?
Yeah, but the CVs never gets renewed.
This was an hour after the wedding, and he's telling her, I'm going to stab you in the hand with a fork, you fucking cunt.
Right. Well, that's Scottish for I love you, right?
No one... usually in a situation like that... You go, hey, calm down, Brian. And we're like, oh, I wanted to say that too so bad.
People were just like, aw.
Yeah, she is a cunt. Why did you marry her?
I went to Old Bisbee earlier today.
Stop bullshit.
Just to check it out. And I saw something I'd never seen before. Half the businesses were closed, but they had their hours on there. And a lot of them said, you know, if I'm open, I'm open.
Yeah.
They open at 11-ish. But one of them said this. Rest in peace, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Store open Friday, Saturday, 11 to 6, and 25 minutes from 8:30 to 8:55. I have the picture.
That was the emergency room.
It was called like midnight, something midnight. I'm going to show you this.
What did they sell, bric-a-brac? Like obviously non-essentials.
Yes, you don't get a lot of essentials in this town.
Like turquoise jewelry and shit like that.
Yeah.
Here you go.
A copper bracelet.
Sweet midnight.
I have no idea.
Rest in peace.
That's an 818 number. That's an 818 number. That's some fucking LA douche that moved out here and goes, oh, I can be lazy out here. And I'm going
to. If you're closed and you're dying to shop, please call our cell. We are usually only 1.5 minutes away. So it's like you can call them up and they'll come and sell you shit.
It's like a volunteer fire
department. It's very clever, though, because once you've called somebody to a shop, you kind of feel obliged to buy something.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah.
But what market research went into, we need to be open Friday and Saturday from 8:30 to 8:55? Like, what?
But it's like your body. They know Bisbee. You shouldn't question them. Like, just let them do what they know is right.
They did market research. That's when people tend to spend the most.
That's it.
8:30 to 8:55.
Yeah, the first time I came to Bisbee to visit Doug, I was in one of those little shops in the main street, and I was looking at rubbish. And some kid came in and went, hey, that guitar in the window, how much is it? And the guy said, it's $35. And he says, oh, I got some rocks I could trade you. And I was thinking, I was like going, good luck with that. And the guy went, oh, let's see them.
No.
Please, sir, can I have some more?
We've already talked about this on a podcast, I think, but one time we were selling merch in Lexington, Kentucky, and, you know, my fan base, some fucking just riff-raff kids, he came up with a handful of loose cigarettes trying to trade them for merch.
Nice, Lucy's.
Holy.
Yeah. Did they do it?
No. They were already a problem before that. Oh, and okay. They were, I think, doing it to be dicks. But you guys, you're on the road now all the time.
Yeah. Twice a month, right?
2 weekends a month, yep.
Do you do merch?
We do.
Yeah, we do.
Do you have, like, do you get psychos that come, like...
We don't really handle it, really.
We did. We
you don't sign shit?
We do.
We do. We sign it in advance, though, and just put it out.
But do you ever get people that want way more than a show?
Yeah, we deal with that a lot, actually.
Yeah. I mean, we used to do all the merch ourselves, and then we got a little bit of help with it. But it still is kind of like, I don't know. Like, when we meet everyone, they bring all the merch with them, and then they ask us to do stuff with it.
Yeah, I mean, other than signing and photographs, do you ever have a guy that just needs to talk to you?
Yeah, we got the talkers. We got can you call my son, daughter, wife? We got that a lot of
make a video for my kids who can't come.
Leave an outgoing greeting on my thing.
We got that, sure.
Say Larry. Hey, will you say Larry on my outgoing greeting?
I push
greeting?
Him towards Joe on that. It's great.
And you don't want to say no, but if you do one, then the whole line behind sees it.
Oh,
and then it's
that's
a million
the
Larry
worst.
Messages. Yeah. Yeah.
Bingo. I yell at Bingo a lot sometimes. She'll go, oh, no, wait, have him sign. No, if they don't want you to sign it and you suggest it, everyone else wants it. Everyone else would just keep going.
They do that. One guy, like, we play ourselves in the show. We're ourselves. So people feel like they know us a little bit. There's this familiarity.
Yeah, yeah.
There's no filter. And they'll come up to us and grab our ass, really, you know, because we joke on the show. So we must want to get our ass grabbed. Like, I'll be at, like, Target and I'll get, like, punched in the shoulder. And I'll turn and the wife's already on. And he's just like... Talk to my wife. I'm just like, hi. But one time I got into an accident. I was driving to see my grandparents, and I was at a red light, and a car rear-ended a car that rear-ended me.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
So I jerked forward. The thing is, though, is that the cops and ambulance were already on the side of the road because an accident had already happened right there.
So it's fucking rubbernecker cars.
I was in the middle of a rubbernecking thing, and so when I got hit, literally, the physical cop and EMT people were standing 1 foot away from my car, and I was already stopped. So they saw the whole thing, and my neck whipped forward and whipped back. And I was on the phone with my dad, and I was like, "Dad, let me call you back. I'm okay, but I just got into an accident." The guy, EMT worker, comes around. I lower my window. I'm holding my neck, and he sticks his head and he goes, "Is this a bad time to ask for your autograph?" And I was like,
"That's great."
I was holding my neck, and I was like, "Dude, I mean, I've never been out of line with anyone, but I was like, dude, I'm holding my neck. You just started." So he goes, "All right." So I pull over, and he goes, "All right, you got to go to the hospital." I said, "I don't want to go to the hospital." He goes, "If you don't want to go to the hospital, you got to fill out paperwork." He goes, "I filled most of it out for you." He puts in my name, first and last, Staten Island, all this other stuff. So I said, "Okay, thanks, man." He goes, "Can I just get a picture?" I said, "Sure." Then he says, "You got to do me one favor.
Oh.
The ambulance that's right there from the accident before you, the lady inside of it is a huge fan." She goes, He goes, can you do me a favor? Can you just go in there and say hello to her? It'll make her day. She just got in an accident." I said, "I don't feel comfortable doing that." And he said, "Can you do it?" So I said, "All right, I'll do it. I don't know. So I'm holding my neck. I walk over. He said, go ahead. I opened the ambulance myself, right? I opened the back door myself. I opened the doors. There's a lady in a stretcher, completely locked down, in a neck brace, and she's staring straight up in, like, the mummified position, staring straight up, and she can't even look up at me. So I opened it, and I go, "Hello?" And she goes, "Yes." And I said, "Hey." And she goes, "Who's this?" I go, "It's Sal from Impractical Jokers." And she goes... And?
Oh,
and I said, "No, nothing. I just hope everything's okay." And I closed the door. And I look, I look at the fucking guy, and I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? This lady's in a fucking stretcher. And I'm like, do you have Channel 1 million? It's me.
How on earth did he even think he knew that she was a fan?
I don't know, because she had no recognition of me whatsoever.
But that's a, like, that's the classic Frank Sinatra, Don Rickles story.
Oh, yes, yes.
For those who don't know, Don Rickles kept bothering Frank Sinatra at a party. Will you please? My wife's a big fan. Will you come over to our table at some point? I don't want to ask, but she's a big fan. If you could just come over and say hello, you know. And they're at a different table, and finally Frank Sinatra comes over to their table and says, "Hi, I'm Frank Sinatra." And Don Rickles says, "Hey, we're eating here."
He turned it on.
I might have fucked that story up, but that's a huge Chinese telephone of that story. Yeah, I was not great at that dinner. But you haven't got to the psycho where someone's talking, like, you know what? I watch your show, but they, you don't get the, like, freak. You haven't had the freak.
We get, like, sometimes with once or twice.
Where you go, this guy's a troubled person.
Yeah. You just, I just try to be nice. Because nobody ever comes up to us.
I'm talking about the one that know you and need, like, the one that's going to, like, live in your house. Like, the woman who went into Letterman's house and they're in love with you.
A couple of them once or twice, but I mean, nothing really.
Have you ever had somebody write in saying they're considering suicide?
Yeah,
we get some of that too. That is like, well, what are you going to do about that? That's like just a disturbed person. What are you going to do? I can't. I don't even know what to say.
Does it creep you out, like, now because you're kind of new famous?
Yeah, I had one where they looked up every. My address, my home address, all my previous addresses, and my family members' addresses. And they typed up a letter. It was seven, 10-page letter. They typed it up. And they sent a copy to, like, 8 addresses. My mom got it. My dad got it. I got it. My old address got it. It got forwarded to me. And I opened it up, and it was a rambling letter from a person, a guy named Pat. And he wanted to date me. And he told me about his life and everything, and he went so far as to... And one part of the letter, he just itemized his physical possessions. So he's like, I have a PlayStation, I have 2 televisions, I have 2 refrigerators.
Wait, 2 televisions, 46 inches.
It was itemized. It was like, I was like, man, I got really nervous. So I was, I happened to be at the police station already. Don't answer. I had a business. I had a bar. And I was there for, like, doing something for, like, the
community. You used to own a bar?
Yes.
Okay, you still own a bar?
Yes.
All right.
Keep going, then.
So I was there because of the community board already in a meeting with the new chief, like, police head and everything. And at the end of the meeting, I said, can I talk to you for a second? I said, can I just show you this letter and you just tell me, do I have any reason to just, is it best if I just show you this? Because this has freaked me out a little bit. And he was like, oh, there's nothing we can really do, whatever. I later found out that Pat... I don't know why I went to that it was a guy, but it was a woman. And she then started sending
And then out. Saturday Night Live stole the entire idea from you. That. Oh,
right. And then she started sending
like
invitations.
Food and shit.
Well, she sent us she sent all of us an invitation to her child's ninth
she the one.
Reptile-themed birthday party.
Got it. I remember this now. Right? Yeah.
And it came and it was like, a glorious invitation. It was in a tin.
She made macaroni fucking pictures on it.
Yeah,
and shit
you
like
opened
that.
It up and it was like a lizard, but it like folded out like an accordion. Yeah. And it was like this high end like lizard reptile invitation. And then in it dropped out 2 nudes of her.
And the worst.
What?
The worst pushing, nudes you could ask for.
I mean, God bless her, but she was pushing like 300 pounds. And she took selfies of herself
in a tub.
Just wet.
With just her giant pontoon tits floating in the water. And like
please join me for like Sue Ann's 9th reptile. Right there.
I would have a really hard time not showing up at that party.
We did. We put them up. We put them up in the office. We put them on the wall in the office. We stapled them to the wall. They might even still be there.
Oh my god! Yeah. I'd go with friends.
We should have went.
We should have went. I know.
Yeah. Again, it's probably a bad thing. But I would have gone if it was not my hometown.
She was out of St. Louis.
Yeah. We're lucky. Most people are very nice to us. We don't really deal with a lot of jerks or anything like that.
Yeah, no. Well, you are nice people. Your show. Again, I feel like I know you from your show.
Right.
Even though now I know you.
Right. Right.
But I still feel like I know you more from your show.
Right.
I'm just gonna say, now can we talk about the bar?
If you like.
How long have you had a bar?
It's not a. The bar is boring. I've had it for 3 years with two friends.
Oh.
In Staten Island, where I'm from.
Not these friends.
Not these guys, no. A couple other buddies we bought it 3 years ago. I worked at a bar for 8 years prior to that.
Uh-huh.
And I managed a bar restaurant. And so then I had the opportunity to buy into something, and I did it.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, no, I can order you a drink.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Bud Light's one.
Oh, Jesus. Oh.
You guys are the best.
Clink, clink.
Go Seahawks.
Yeah, we didn't.
Sorry.
No, no, bro.
I'm an alcoholic OCD. If we all toast and I miss someone, I go.
Can't have that.
That'll happen.
What's Staten Island like?
It's fucking beautiful. It's an oasis.
Uh huh.
No, it's nice. It's really nice, actually. It's a little too much traffic, but other than that, it's kind of like
and
nice.
And you all live there?
We all grew up there. Now right. James and Joe live in Manhattan. Sal and I still live there.
We still live there.
A couple of rough years that I had the dump there. And I call those rough years my childhood. But like now that the dump's closed down, it's...
And
it's
is it all nice. Like firemen and police?
Pretty much. It's
a
lot.
Heavy working class Irish...
Garbage men.
Irish, Italian. Yeah. Like that. Like blue collar.
Blue
like
collar. City. A lot of city workers.
My dad is a retired sanitation worker.
Yeah.
You know, like everywhere else, there's assholes. You know, and they get a bad rap, especially in media, like for like... You know who I am type people, you know, oh, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But as just as much as that, there are the people that we've come to love and everything. It's good. It's right near the city. It's like a 10-minute drive, 15 minutes if there's no traffic. So it's like access to New York, but it's also like a bit of suburbia.
It's a weird psyche to come from Staten Island because it is growing up on an island. A lot of people, it is an island. So it like limits your radar of geography. Like everything is within the 7x14 mile. So that alone kind of makes you unique in the United States, let alone New York. And then on top of that, it's very white, very Italian, very Catholic. So then that creates its own point of view. And then on top of that, the rest of the city shits on you. Uh-huh. Like you're the forgotten borough, you're kind of a joke borough, like when we were growing up. So then you have a defensiveness too. I would say like...
So is that why you became so racist?
Yeah, no. I'm racist because of other races.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, okay. not because of me.
Them.
Yeah, what are you talking
other
about?
Other races.
No, get out of here. I just want to point to Emily right there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we're, right. Hey, Emily's every race.
I'm everyone.
I was thinking the same song.
Yeah.
All right, let's stop this Staten Island shit. Maybe we can cut that out.
I gave an insightful answer.
Road pussy. Who's single of the four of you?
Well, I mean, there's my road pussy right there. So.
Yeah, yeah. You're excluded from the conversation.
Who's single?
Because you did the show, and now you go out and you do gigs twice a month.
Yeah.
Improv thing. I don't know what you call it. Uh-huh. You do a show.
Yeah.
Who's is Joe single?
Joe's got married in September, and I was the reverend. Joe's recently married.
Yeah.
Right.
So Joe's the only one who's married.
And
but when you first started road pussy, do you get hit on?
We get hit on. That we do. That happens. And I realize that it doesn't take much. If you're just on TV for a second, people just have this weird obsession with a public figure. You know, it didn't give me any more confidence. It actually made me feel worse.
Mm. Yeah, because you know, eventually you're going to hate this. That's what I always felt. You're just fucking me because I was 4 feet higher than the rest of the room with a microphone. And eventually you're going to go, oh, I can't believe I did that. And some husband of yours is going to go, you fucked that guy? And say, it wasn't good. Like I want to explain to you before you fuck me that you're only fucking me for. Has anyone got road pussy? You can't talk to your friends.
No. I'll be honest with you. I'm a neurotic person. You're talking to the wrong person about this. I'm a neurotic person, so my brain does the inverse of what it should. Instead of being like,
what you need is a fucking. This is Sal's pussy. Bingo cleaned it out. There's a post-it note on her fucking
no, I'd pubic still piss bone. On it. I'd piss all over it. I'd ruin it for him. I wouldn't let him have that pussy.
And that would be ruining the whole sentiment of that clean pussy. No. What I say to myself is, wait a minute. You can't just get me that easily. You don't know me. I just met you. Now you're going to say, let's go fuck after this? I'm not that easy. That's what I say. I reverse it in my head.
Is that a great feeling? Like, I get to a place where, like, hey, I grew up in a world where you have to do every song and dance, fucking step and fetch it to get pussy. Oh, but now I can get it for free because I talked on stage. And there's a great feeling about turning chicks down and seeing that look on her face. Right?
I'm hot.
Everyone in Wichita would fuck me. And you're going to say no?
I think if I could just cut straight through the bullshit.
Oh.
Is after a show, we are so tired. We are the fucking oldest. We don't even go out. Like, we don't even go to bars or anything. Like, after it, we make a beeline for the hotel room.
We go out like one out of 10 times.
Yeah, it's really, we're kind of lame. We probably should enjoy it more, but after shows, we're done.
Yeah, no, being old, but that's the thing. You, with that newfound fame, well, you had fame because you're a fucking New York firefighter, right, so you get pussy for,
I just got hit in the face with it. Yeah.
I fantasize.
I put out fires with all the pussy that I got. I would just tunnel it towards the fire and just a wave.
The most pussy I got was when I was young and had no act, where I feel like I should go back and go, I'm sorry that you fucked me for that act. I was 2 years in. I really, those jokes stank. Like, it's really more me than you.
Ten minutes.
I was more of a hack than you are a whore, and I apologize on Facebook.
10 minutes left of our show, I literally start like being like, oh my God, like there's five huge pillows in the bed.
Yeah, we're pretty lame.
I just can't, like, I'm going to like have a pillow like everywhere. And that's what I'm thinking about. I really am. I'm just like, I just want to go like watch cable and just lay down.
It's true.
Is that really bad?
No, I'm like that now, but I would, that's what I'm saying. You guys are in your 30s?
38. Well, he's 30, we're 37.
37. Yeah.
Which is too old.
So for the first time, though, you're getting like pussy you couldn't get before.
Well, you're really making this sound like I never got a pussy in my entire life.
Well, you were a bartender. Bartenders do well.
Yeah, you did good.
All I need is a fucking can of Pabst. I'm at least getting fingered. I'm getting fingered. Notice.
I know. I liked it. I ran it through the processor. Yeah. It went well.
I'm not touching anyone.
What did the other two do? What were their previous jobs?
James was and still is. He was a producer for reality shows.
Oh.
He's the one that like, he'll watch a reality show that's successful.
Mur. No, who's James?
Are you okay?
Who's James?
Mur. Like, Mur will watch a television show that's successful, and then he'll come up with, like, different versions of it and go out and sell it. So that's what he did.
Oh, we'll call him the American way now.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Don't get me wrong. Like, without Murray and his business ingenuity, we wouldn't have this show. So it's like we need that.
There is a you and Sal. There's a Q and Sal versus Murr and Joe kind of. I don't know if I think that because I know you two and I don't know them.
I don't know if versus is the right word. Yeah, I wouldn't say versus. It's just they don't drink. We do drink. We still live on Staten Island.
That's why you're here and they're not.
Yeah. You know what I mean? This is, but we're all on the same team. There's no,
we are.
There's always okay, that guy. Okay, fuck,
I know you,
you
understand that. I'm just saying that in case Murray listens to this. Which he won't. So don't worry about it. So.
But we're happy to fulfill those roles on the show. It helps like promote the show. Like it is. There's some truth to it. Even Murray will say that. But then we play it up for the show.
I didn't know if that was from the show or just because you guys talked to me and they didn't.
Fucking real. We play it up for the show.
Like, how close were you guys before the show? Like, were you always just the four of you, or do you have other lives?
Oh, we have other lives.
Was there a fifth guy who didn't get on the show and is really pissed off.
Is there a Pete Best?
Yes, there is.
He's not pissed off.
Well, no, it's a weird. It's not like yes and no. It's not like that. Way back when we started the Tenderloins, which is the comedy troupe that we are like outside of the show, we had another guy named Mike, and he did it with us.
I wasn't in.
He was not in.
Like that was.
You're the Ringo.
You're the Ringo Starr.
I'm the Ringo. Yeah, without a doubt. But, well, I like to say they didn't get successful till I joined. That's the way I like to put it. So
that's what Ringo says.
Exactly. Ringo's right.
Yeah.
The first 5 or 6 years, we just did like sketch and improv on stage, and it was like in 2006 when Q came on board, and Mike actually. I mean, we had been at this quite some time, and like he had a really successful job. He now has a family, a wife, and like it was kind of like it was. The more successful he got his other job, the harder it was for him to dedicate to make an internet video. And so,
you said to Mike, "You're fired."
We kept making internet videos, you know, and that was when YouTube first started and all that stuff. And so, it took off from there, which is kind of not what we did with him. And so, it was like a mutual thing; it wasn't anything.
All right,
he's still like
he's great. He comes to set. He's a lot of fun.
Yeah,
and believe me, he's doing better than we are. Like he's got a wonderful wife. He's got gorgeous kids. He makes more money than we make. He's not looking at us like Pete Best.
Not
he's fun.
Not yet. Yeah. Not yet.
We almost had Pete Best play at my bar. He's affordable, so I don't know. Maybe that's why.
I've gotten emails where we, God damn it, it's like someone said, "Hey, will you play our dumb party we do every year?"
Yeah.
Last year we got. So-and-so for $500.
Oh, fuck. Was it Hannibal Buress or was it...
No, it was a celebrity.
It was a golfer? No. It was the fucking... It was Ben Johnson.
Oh, yeah, Ben Johnson.
It was Canada. We're doing the tour of Canada, and there's an email from somebody saying, "Hey, I see you've got a vacant date between London and Toronto. Can you come out and do our gun owners
London,
club
Ontario.
Or something?"
Sure. Yeah, whatever. Last year we had Ben Johnson for
$500. Holy shit! He ain't doing so great.
Well,
you could probably get the entire U.S. track team from the Moscow Olympics.
If I could run that fast from a gig,
what did he do? What did he do?
I don't know.
What he just made a celebrity appearance and
are you
hung around
at that peak of? Isn't that like? No,
this is like last year.
Okay.
So he had so they had him 2 years ago.
Okay.
Bear in mind, he was a disgraced drug cheat. Right. So his income was kind of limited, imagine.
Okay. If you still get a job.
And not when you're black.
Hmm.
Just saying.
Hmm.
Don't blame me. Blame society.
Do you get people that try to book you and then get pissed off?
Nobody tries to book us anywhere.
Well, I told you I got that fucking great idea for you.
Yeah, it's a great idea.
Nobody tries to.
We get a little bit.
Who?
Book us in what way?
Like going to a party or a club or something?
To
like
make
that?
An appearance?
Yeah.
I think that we haven't gotten many of those. There's only a few offers here and there when we're on the road and someone knows that we're going to be on the road.
It's not an offer. It's like after your show, come and hang out.
Did you ever get representation? Last time I talked to you when I was drunk when we had
do.
That great
We
idea.
Have everything now. Okay. We have everything.
Yeah, we got soup to nuts.
All right, so I'm making sure you're not getting all of your money. I want make sure some fucking loser in a fucking cubicle at whatever CAA or PAA or
ACA,
one of those. Yeah. I wanted to make sure those guys are getting well fed.
Yeah, because it's not enough that I split every dollar I make four ways, Doug. I also now have to give it to fucking to those guys.
It's like a band.
Yeah.
Murray says you're lucky to get a quarter.
Dr. Ken is here.
He's right.
Hang on.
Exactly
Dr.
Right.
Ken is here from The Hangover. Come on in.
Who are you?
Oh, sorry. From a distance, you looked Asian. A walker. Wait, no, come back. Get in here. No, we've been waiting for a guy to show up that no one has no idea who he is.
Yeah, who are you?
I think I know who he is.
No, who are you? You?
What about you, dude? Do you even know who you are?
Put him on mic. Get him
John.
On mic. All right, here's what happened.
John looks unhinged
John,
to me. I'm not going to lie.
Oh, it's been a long day.
Yeah, John, you look crazy.
John, talk into the mic. Do I know you?
Well, I saw you the other night at Roca.
You have to project.
Roca, Cafe Roca.
Okay, so.
That's a no.
Last year's Super Bowl, right before it, I did Joe Rogan's podcast.
Yes.
And I was shit-faced. And I said, yeah, no, anyone can come over for football in Bisbee. It's not like people. We live so far away from anything. You're not going to get party crashers. And we got probably a dozen. And of a dozen, 10 of them were cool. And 2 were fucking problems. But we had Chad Shank. Well, there was one guy crying out, right? And one guy that was had to be like hoisted out. So
yeah,
this year we said we're going to – anyone you go – I mean, I don't know a lot of people here anyway because I don't remember folks. Or I know the person they're with and they brought friends.
Yeah.
And then we go, look for walkers, the guy that just showed up and no one knows. He's hiding in the corner and looking weird. So you, I think, are a walker.
Yeah, well, I mean, Jennifer told me she's coming over here.
Jennifer from the park.
Jenny from the block?
Jenny from the from Roca, yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Oh, Jenny. Melissa Reeves and Jen.
Yeah,
okay.
Melissa Reeves.
All right. Yeah. But you wandered into a house that you don't even know where the fuck you are, so I thought you're a weird walker.
Yeah.
So, okay. That's all right. You're fine. All right,
well, you cool. still found your way down the secret door steps down here, so you kind of are in walker territory, right?
Yeah, you did. Yeah. But you did drop a name, okay. That's all. I thought you were a fucking real weirdo, and I was hoping you were weirder.
Oh, no, yeah, I was upstairs, and then I was just like... checking out the place. I mean, it's a nice place to explore.
Right. Don't worry, we'll cut all this out.
Cut it all out.
All right. Last night I asked him the fucking one bit you did on Impractical Jokers that like really fucking hurt, where you're like, fuck you, I don't want to do this. Like the one thing that personally you didn't have to Johnny Knoxville and act like, oh, that kick in the balls really hurt for showbiz, but really fucked with you. Because I was asking how pissed off you were about, like, when they had your sister getting her tit grabbed. You looked really pissed. I don't understand why. I think that's funny.
It's funny. I know. I recognize that's funny.
What bit did you do on Impractical Jokers where you're like, fuck, come on, fuck you guys. You really got mad at people.
Mm-hmm. There's a couple, like the elephant. I don't want to go harp on the elephant stuff, but that was pretty bad. Because you know how I am. And that was 50 pounds of whatever.
The bit was where they hid his car keys in a mountain of elephant dung. Right. That he had to like search. Bula. Am I wrong?
No, that's it. I mean, and it was 100 degrees. You could smell it from fucking.
Isn't it like seaweed though? Isn't it just like not it's all vegetable matter?
Yeah,
right?
But not at 100. No, but it's not at 100 degrees, man.
It's like cow shit or horse shit.
We eat mushrooms
human
out of cow shit.
If you make it me stunk. Dig through human shit, yes. Oh, that smell is different.
I was breaking it apart though because I didn't know where the keys were. It was bad, and
it's
I was
like an adobe brick, dude. Which this right. this house is made of adobe brick.
Well, I could just tell you from
straw.
My personal experience.
and from our housekeeping skills, it probably smells like elephant shit.
I almost threw up. And then when they broke into my house, I was pretty in shock.
Hey, you
yes,
know,
you looked in shock.
The thing about that elephant thing, you know, that originally wasn't, I don't think we've ever said this before, that originally wasn't supposed to be your punishment. We had worked out a deal with the tiger people that we were going to put his keys just out of reach of a tiger's fucking, like the tiger was going to be on a chain and it was going to be prowling around and Sal had to approach and we didn't tell him this, but the keys were so the tiger couldn't get it.
Yeah.
And we were going to watch him approach a tiger.
Until the chain snaps.
And then the day of, that day,
absolutely.
They were like, we can't do it.
Wait a minute. Nature always finds a way. Honestly.
Ian Malcolm over here.
No, I'm with you on that one. In feces that is meat eater, that's another thing. That's like a human. And then
well, I did that too.
Trusting an animal trainer just means you're trusting someone who doesn't even have a GED. There's no fucking way that guy knows the tensile strength of the chain. That's you will lose an arm. You will lose an arm.
It's kind of true too, is like dating someone's daughter. You don't know who raised her. You don't know what fucking it's the same thing. You can get your heart ripped out by a fucking tiger bitch. Yeah.
I don't know her tensile strength.
But neither does he.
I was afraid of the elephant too, just swipe me.
Oh, that elephant!
You know,
adorable.
Just swipe me. But when my sister, I think, was a pretty bad one.
I don't know, man.
Just grabbing my sister's.
What happened in that? I never saw that one.
We were teaching corporate sensitivity and ethics training, And they said, I'm going to play a video now to show you like some examples of what not to do in the workplace. And when I pressed play, my sister was a secretary. I didn't know this. And he walked in and said, do you have those reports? And she said, yes, I do. And then he reached in and just literally started manhandling her tits.
Yeah. In my defense, this is really good looking.
Yeah.
So you have to keep that in mind.
And nice tits, by the way. Yeah. Tell your sister. Does she listen to the podcast? I know Murr won't. But if your sister, nice, like, succulent.
Well, she's young. Full. Yeah. We had to call, before we shot that bit, we called his dad and asked permission. We did. Like, it was like an old school Italian thing. We were like, if you see his dad is fucking, what is his dad, like 60-something now? 68, and he's jacked. He's the only word for him is jacked. He's fucking
so Staten
big.
Island is still some sort of patriarchal society where you can afford up a man and say, "Can I feel your daughter's tits?"
Yeah, if you don't want trouble later on, it might be best to do that. I didn't ask him. I'm not afraid of him. His dad though can wipe the floor.
All right, go ahead. No, go.
I just had one thought, but it's
say it.
I remember one time where I almost got threw up from nervousness because you lied to me as well.
Sure.
It was when I had to I was a book author, and they had my book there, and it was a whole like place full of people, and I was going to read an excerpt.
The bookstore, with an audience.
What they told me before was they said you're going to read a passage. It's about your real life, and I said okay, you know. I said just what is it about, and they're like they literally all just looked at me and were like look. They said they lied. Joe was like, I fought them on it, but it was 2-1, and they won. And we wrote some really personal shit that you don't want anyone to know about. And it's you're going to be upset. You're going to be really upset. And, you know, we can't say no to a punishment. We can't say no. So I just got.
I like fucking people that play by real rules.
Love it. Yeah. So I got sick to my stomach because what was going through my head was the worst of the worst. Like, what am I going to say right now? My family, to these public, to the public, and then when I opened it up, it was blank. Of course, it was blank.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah.
But I was visibly shaken on screen. You could see if you see that.
That
one.
Was great.
Yeah,
that's why you're my kind of favorite.
Yeah, you could say it's okay. Though. It's fine.
You look
it's fine.
Like you always want to puke. shit!
I know I'm Bingo's favorite. And that's enough. That's enough for me. I'll take it.
One bit that you fought to get in that got cut.
Oh, we just had actually last week's episode was nothing but clips that we had fought to get on, that we shot and fought to get on. The network
we
said
talked
no.
about that last night.
Oh, did we? Shit, I see. I forgot about last week's
episode. But something that you fought to get on that you couldn't even get on that episode.
Oh,
like
okay.
Something that was so, like, this is fucking funny, you cunts. The man show, I did that, and I'm like, don't open with that episode because I knew it was weak as shit, and I knew most of them were weak as shit. But this episode had funny shit, and I laid on my back in front of Stone Stanley, and I hope you're out of, and I screamed and yelled and did a fake baby tantrum on the floor. Please put this episode not there. Don't so open funny. With that because it's going to stink.
And what happened?
They used the one they wanted to use. It didn't work. But is there a bit that you like, this is the funniest fucking thing, and I can't believe you're not airing it?
There was like a handful. Like,
did Black Not Scarier? Did that ever end up airing?
No, never aired, no.
That was when we fought really hard and we lost, where we were doing this thing where we went up to people in the park and we said, you know, hey, man, you went up with a camera. And you said, hey, do you mind if I take a picture of you for my blog? You're perfect for it. And then the guys would tell you what the blogs were.
Yeah, boy,
so there was one that killed us. And when the crew, like we've been with the same crew for 3 years, when they come up to you and they're like, that was fucking unbelievable.
That's when
you know you have the gold.
That's when management is going to fucking shit again.
Yeah, exactly. That's what happened.
Everyone likes it.
Because they had me go up to this fucking ripped black guy and his white girlfriend.
Shirtless.
He's just walking around with you. Because he can. Because if I looked like him, I'd walk around shirtless too. Absolutely. There's a reason I wear 3 shirts a day. So like, I went up to him and I go, hey, man, you're perfect for my blog. He looked like DJ from Street Fighter, like the new one, like the fucking Jamaican guy that was ripped, just kicking everybody's ass. And I go, okay, you're perfect for my blog. It's called Black Not Scary. And
Black but not scary.
And they said it in my ear, and it came out of my mouth without me even thinking. Right? I just said black not scary, and then I went whoop, zink, and if I had a hat on, it would have spun in the air. And I just stood back and I went, oh.
He was 2 feet taller than you.
He was huge. I mean, make no mistake, he would have torn me apart as if I was made of tissue paper. It would have been horrible. And he, and it was a tense moment. And then he just started laughing, this beautiful laugh. And I was like, I'm going to live. And like I heard them, because you could hear him in the ear going, oh, I can't believe he said it. I saw the cameraman going like this, like the security guy who normally doesn't do anything, like got at the ready, like to come at me and shit like that. So we came back, and they were like, we can't believe you said it. How the fuck did you say it? Blah, blah, blah. And everybody was so excited. And the network was just like, that's racist. That will never air on this network. And we were like, are you fucking kidding me? It's what the show is at its best. It's like fucking saying shit you shouldn't say to people.
He laughed.
He loved it. His girlfriend laughed. Really, they signed. He let me take the picture. They signed. It was great. And they won't let it air ever.
What about bits where you showed it, but you've cut so that you're not seeing the full person's response or something like that?
Yeah, that happens a lot. It happens a lot. We fight a lot.
No, yeah. I mean, yeah, like I'm talking about the way that somebody reacts to you, even though they've signed the release, like you don't actually see what they actually said.
There was a time where we were at a food court in a mall, and I was a janitor sweeping up, and they said, oh, just like grab this fork, tape it to the end of your broomstick, and then just spear this guy's chicken while he's eating him. Just take him while he's in the mall. And I went up behind him. And like the broom, it was like one of those like cartoons, like a long fork. It just like he was eating, and you just saw the fork, like, and then he saw the fork and didn't even move.
He just watched
the fork, and it went in and it went out. And then he like slowly looked back with it, and I put it in my mouth, and I chewed, and I just went, they don't give me a lunch break. And then he got up and was like, you don't know me. I don't know you. Yeah, and he just started screaming like, who does that to somebody? You don't fucking know who I am. You don't know me. You don't do that. And I was just like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. And then I just was like, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And then, like, he wasn't really having it. Then we had to tell him it was a thing. And then he, like, was okay with it. But they cut it out, like, right at, like,
yeah.
Like they cut all the. They
don't want to make us seem like assholes. They want us to be likable. So yeah, always kind of cut that shit.
Well, I can't imagine any of you fighting. And who's the least scared of fisticuffs?
Probably me. I would say me. I don't. I've been in fights. Like I've taken punches. I say it to Murray all the time. I'm like I've taken
Joe's
punches.
Joe's the biggest. Joe Gatto is the biggest.
Joe has never been in a fight in his entire life.
I know, but he seems like the least afraid of
getting
hit.
Oh, you're talking about just balls on the show?
Yeah, least afraid of getting hit.
Oh, I thought you meant least afraid of getting hit. Like, literally, like, I know I could take a hit. I thought you meant.
Joe is the ballsiest, but Joe is the first one not to want any confrontation.
Yeah, he won't. He'll back out in a second if it's that sort of thing.
Murray is. I don't know if Murray could really back himself up, but also Murray.
He's so pixie-esque. He wouldn't ever. Right. No one would ever hit that guy. Yeah. Like, you would have to be the biggest cunt in the world to hit fucking Murr.
We almost got decked. We were doing a Fiat. Hawking Fiat cars for like a special promotion.
Yeah, yeah.
And they said, there was this couple that came up and they said, just stay behind them the whole time. Only talk from behind them. So we went behind the guy and his girl, and I guess he sensed something was a little off. And the guy was like another big dude, and he was like an MMA dude. And we didn't even do anything. It went from 0 to 60. We went right behind him, and I said, can I show you that? And I like went right up to their ears and like, from behind, I was like, can I show you? And
it was nothing.
What are you doing?
It was nothing.
What are you doing to me and my girlfriend? I was like, I'm just showing you the Fiat. And he was like, he literally put his hands up and was like, I will punch you in your fucking face right now. His hand was right up in my face. And I was just like, I'm just so showing you the Fiat, man. You know? And then he was like, and then his girlfriend was like, stop. He's like, get off. And he just like, he was ready. He was ready.
Something else bothered him that day that he was just there. I was like,
did he sign?
No,
we didn't approach him.
What was this? Was this a car convention or is it appearance?
New York
appearance
Auto Show.
Fee.
New York,
so it's
New
appearance
York
fee. This is live.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you got anyone walking through.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. We told the crew not to even try and sign him. And that crew is scary. We have this. I mean, Chaille is like 4. How? It was 4'2".
She's like
tiny,
10,
but she's the scariest human being I've ever met in my life. Like she will go up to people and just be like, the fuck out of here. Like, the fuck out of my way. Get the fuck. Like, and you're just like, holy shit.
If they're an asshole.
If they're an asshole, well, yeah. So it's like It takes a lot for us not to send our crew after people, but that guy, we were like, I don't even know if Shay could take
it. He was yeah, a half a second away from laying us out.
Who is Stacey Patella?
Stacey Patella, how do you know that name? She's my assistant. She's my friend. She grew up with us, actually.
We're trying to shut this down. You keep fucking leading us into non-closers, Hennigan.
He's been like head down in Google with his face lit up.
Well, I was trying to get out of it, so I was just throwing it in there. Yeah, yeah.
What? There's something there. You see that?
Stacey Patella, you get your name dropped, but right now we have to go play urine roulette.
Yes.
No!
Oh, hey, what important. Time's your flight?
2:30. No, let's go do it. Let's go play this.
Yeah, well, I'm hoping we can go. If you, I don't know what the just condition's going to be like tomorrow, but if we could still see it before we head out, you know.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Breakfast or something, take you out.
We ain't going anywhere.
You won't be getting much sleep tonight anyway, now that we've been in your trailer.
No, you have not. I got the keys, man. Come on. Oh, don't say that.
We know the owners.
Don't
they were
say
here.
That to me.
Yeah.
I had to take a shower. I had to walk to the shower. I was a little freaked about that.
We told you. We told you that
to come here and shower. Yeah.
It was the cool. Where I was staying is probably the coolest place I've ever seen before I got to your house. But you know, the separate shower. I was a little.
But I told them that we have a nice house. We don't even go to up the street. Yeah. Was so, get a clean totally shower.
It was
clean.
The shower there was fine.
Totally fine.
Right. It was very clean and nice. Talking of where you're staying, this podcast has been brought to you by the Shady Dell.
TheShadyDell.com. Yeah. Come to Bissbee. Hang out. If I'm in town, I'll drink a beer with you, and then you have to go.
There you go.
Between 8:35 and 9 o'clock.
There's a sign on the door.
Perfect ending.
The Impractical Jokers. Catch them on TruTV. If you don't have a DVR, I don't even know what you do. Fucking download it. Find it on the internet. One of those things like BitTorrent or something. Steal it.
Thursdays at 10.
Thursday. Thank
you. TruTV.
Yes. Thank you.
All right, that was Sal and Quinn, the two good guys from the Impractical Jokers. Always root against Joe Gatto and Murr. Murr is something you bring people at Christmas if you're a disciple or I don't know. Frankincense. Yeah, frankincense. Frankincense couldn't be here tonight. He missed his flight because he was at the Robin Quivers table. And next week, we'll see you with Andy Andrist. Oh. I shouldn't have done shots of vodka. That was a bad idea. Remember when I said, this is the most sober I've been after the Super Bowl? Oh, that ended quickly. Back to the party. TheShadyDell.com. That is where you stay. If you come to Bissbee and you're staying at the Shady Dell and I'm in town, I will have a beer with you. I won't hang out that long. We're not going to be good friends. I don't want you to fucking tell me you're going to kill yourself. But if you're staying at the ShadyDell.com, vintage trailer park with all 50s, 60s trailers that we live a mile away from, and we look for reasons to go stay there, come to the ShadyDell.com. Sponsored by... I might even come in and clean your toilet. I don't know. Play the Mattoid.
Party time. You've been listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast, recorded live in the Funhouse in Bisbee, Arizona, with Doug Stanhope, Quinn and Sal from Impractical Jokers, Brian Hennigan, and Greg Chaille. Engineered and produced by me, Chaille. This podcast sponsored by The Shady Dell in Bisbee, Arizona. Opening song by Mishka Shubale, Party Time by The Mattoid, both available on iTunes. Check out the new season of Impractical Jokers, Thursdays at 10 on TruTV. And take a listen to Quinn and Sal's podcast, What Say You? Just voted Best New Podcast on Stitcher. Find out about all of Doug's upcoming tour dates by joining the mailing list at DougStanhope.com. Thanks for listening. Dance and dance and shoe your shoes, it's party time. Howl your house and sock your socks, it's party time, yeah. Oh baby, grab your craps and fuck your fox, it's party time. Grab your craps and fuck your fox, it's party time.
Party time, party time, party time, party time, party time. Hey!